Okay, and also for giving me the opportunity to share today some of our recent work at ICFO, done in collaboration with Professor Derek Chen. So today I would like to talk about how one can get a very strong optomechanical coupling between a single photon and a single atom, even in experimental configurations where this wasn't explored before. As has already been introduced in this conference, in the field of cavity optomechanics, we usually have this intuitive picture of a cavity with one of its mirrors connected to a spring. Therefore, the radiation force of this cavity field is able to push the mirror, changing the length of the cavity, and therefore on the frequencies of these cavity modes, which feedbacks into the number of photons inside the cavity. Formally, this translates into a cubic coupling between the cavity light mode and the position of the resonator, which in principle offers a rich venue for applications. However, because of the large cavity line width of these systems, they are usually operated at a strong driving, because then the single photon coupling is enhanced by the number of photons. Formally, this linearizes the Hamiltonian, which limits the range of non-classical effects that can appear in the system. Therefore, a holy grail in the field consists on reaching the non-linear cavity optomechanical limit that appears when the single photon, single phonon coupling is able to superate the cavity decay, because it is in this limit that even the uncertainty of the zero-point motion of the resonator is able to effectively bring the system in or out of resonance. The best experiments today, however, for example, using crystal cavities or whispering cavities, are typically two orders of magnitude away from this regime. And then the question we address in this work is whether one can still get strong optomechanical effects even when the single photon coupling is smaller than the cavity decay. For this, an optical resonator is going to be an atom, because atoms have very low masses that allow for very large zero-point motion, making them very good candidates as optical resonators. This atom is going to be inside a cavity, where we're going to focus on one of the cavity modes. The goal is that the position of this atom highly influences the frequencies of the cavity. And this interaction can be modeled by a James Cummings Hamiltonian that describes a process where an excited level of the atom can decay to the ground state, emitting a photon that populates the cavity. Therefore, this process is dictated by the coupling parameter that characterizes how well the effective dipole of the atom couples to the cavity, and is weighted by the shape of this cavity mode, so that this coupling is maximum when the atom is placed at the cavity antinode, but disappears if the atom is placed at the node of the cavity. As the position of the atom is going to play such a prominent role, we want to have a good control on that. And this can be obtained by using an external trap that harmonically confines the atom in a given position of the cavity and naturally quantizes its motion in terms of phonons. This system is also going to couple to the environment through different channels, and one of them is going to be used to drive and read out the system. So this can look like a very simple toy model, but actually describes the, many relevant experiments today. So for example, the situation where an atom is optically coupled to the evanescent field of a photonic crystal. So as has already been introduced in the conference, these photonic crystals are crystal cavities with some 1D array of defects tailored on them that shapes tailors the shape of this evanescent field. Photons in this cavity can leak into free space, but also can emit into a waveguide that is used to drive and read out the system and to input a given optical field. And in these experiments, in Lukin's group, an external trap allows to position the atom very close to the photonic crystals, where the mode volumes are very small. So this effectively allows to very large couplings in the order of gigahertz, that, however, are still one order of magnitude smaller than the total decay in the cavity. The good news is that these atoms have very narrow line widths in the order of megahertz, so this still allows for very large cooperativities in the order of 20. So then the question is, we want to explore here is where one can find stratomechanical effects in these systems because of this large coupling between the atom and the cavity, even if effectively the coupling parameter is smaller than the cavity decay. And for that, we're going to make use of the narrow line widths of the atom. So just to motivate a bit more the intuition, let me start by picturing the the idea where the system is in a, the atom is in a motionless configuration in a fixed position of the cavity. So you diagonalize your James Cummings Hamiltonian for each position of the atom. What you get is a spectrum that is blocked diagonal in sectors with a fine number of excitations. In particular, we're going to focus on the single excitation space that are given by phonons or single excitations of the atom. If here, if the atom is placed at the north of the cavity, this spectrum just corresponds to the bare frequencies of the atom and the cavity. But now, as the atom moves closer to the cavity antinode, the atomic state starts hybridizing with the cavity, and their energies start getting shifted. In particular, for our purpose, we want that very small variations in the position of the atom translates into very different shifts. So therefore, we are interested in the maximum slope of this variation that appears when the atom is placed halfway in between the cavity node and the cavity antinode. So this is the position where we're going to center an external trap for the atom. So now, if we drive in resonance the trace atomic frequency of an atom that is placed at the center of the trap, one can look into which is the response of the cavity. In particular, we can look into which fraction of an incoming field gets reflected. And if we square this quantity, this gives us a reflectivity that depends on the position of the atom. So if the atom is placed at the center of the trap, the system is in resonance with the incoming field, and for a balanced cavity configuration, it translates into zero reflectivity. However, if now the atom moves from the center of the trap, the system gets out of resonance with an incoming photon that cannot excite any level, and therefore gets perfectly reflected. As you see, there is a characteristic length that the atom needs to deviate from the center of the trap in order to bring the cavity out of resonance. And this length is related to the width of the atomic state that is now hybridized by the cavity decay. So this width is actually now dictated by the cooperativity of the system. In particular, if the system has large cooperativity, this effective length that the atom needs to move to bring the cavity out of resonance is just a fraction of the zero-point motion. Therefore, this defines, in this system, a new definition of the strong automechanical coupling limit. And this has important consequences even at the single photon level. For example, let's consider the following situation. Let's say you have an atom that is initially in the motional ground state of your external trap, and there is now an incoming photon. After this photon gets scattered, there are only two possibilities. The first one is the photon gets reflected. But if the photon gets reflected, at that moment we know that it is very unlikely that the atom is at the center of the trap, because the reflectance is very suppressed. Therefore, condition to this detection, to this photon being reflected, the wave function now gets a hole at the center of the trap. In the same manner, if the photon does not get reflected, then the atom is very likely to be at the center of the trap. So then the wave function now has a position uncertainty that is not given anymore by the zero-point motion of the cavity or the trap, but by this effective length that now defines the new length of the system. The result is that even if you are not actively monitoring this scattered photon, you get a highly entangled state where your motional wave function highly entangles with the scattered photon. And this has implications experimentally, because as you see, either of these two possible resulting states is very different from the ground state. In particular, have a larger number of phonons. So therefore, the single photon is hitting the system. And we can compare this heating with the expected number of phonons a single photon would excite in free space, which is just given by the Lambdicki parameter, which is the ratio between the kinetic energy that the photon carries and the energy you need to excite a phonon. In our scattering picture, this can be computed as just the sum of the number of phonons in each of the possible states weighted by the probability that this event happens. So if we compute this quantity for a fixed Lambdicki parameter, as we increase the coupling between the atom and the cavity, what we observe is that the number of phonons that this photon is exciting is enhanced by the cooperativity of the system. It's a scaling that changes in the strong coupling regime and is very well captured by a full master equation simulation of the system. Therefore, the message here is that in systems with large cooperativity, when the response of this system is very sensitive to the position of the atom, there is an enhanced heating that appears and can overpass the expectation in free space. And we hypothesize this is one of the mechanisms that may explain why, in current experiments in photonic crystals, cooling down the atom to the ground state is much more difficult than you would expect if you were neglecting this heating mechanism. So this is like a small evidence, but we've also been looking into characterizing with more detail, more direct signatures of this process taking place. For example, for that, you can explore the situation where you place a detector in the reflection channel so that you have more control on what is happening in the system. So just to motivate what is happening in this case, let's consider that the photon gets reflected. At the moment when the photon is reflected, we know that the atomic state is projecting. Just to simplify the discussion, let's now consider a configuration where the dress atomic frequency that we are driving is the configuration of an atom that is placed closer to the cavity antinode. So that condition to this detection, the wave function now concentrates closer to the antinode of the cavity. So now if we are weakly driving the system, the cavity, there is a characteristic time delay before a second photon arrives. In particular, this time delay can be longer than the characteristic time scales of the cavity. So at this intermediate time, the dynamics of the atom is going to be purely given by the mechanical trap. Therefore, in this intermediate time before a second photon arrives, the atomic wave function is mostly evolving in the trap where it just oscillates from positions closer to the cavity node to the cavity node. As you see, as the wave function explores different regions of the cavities, as the reflectance is so sensitive, the reflectance of the system is going to change accordingly in this evolution. And this can be characterized through second order correlations in time. So let's do this. And what is the expectation we will get? Well, first of all, we know that detection of a photon projects the atomic state in a configuration that is compatible with this reflection having taken place. Therefore, if a second photon arrives at this same moment, with very small delay, you will see a situation that favors another reflection. So therefore, at initial times, we observe bunching. Now, if this delay is longer, the system is allowed to evolve. And in particular, after half a period of the mechanical trap, the wave function is closer to the north of the cavity, where reflectance is very suppressed. So thus, after this time, what we expect is anti-bunching. And this response will just oscillate with a frequency that interestingly is not given by the cavity or the atom or the coupling between them, but is just by the frequency of the trap, which is a rather unique signature. So this interpretation based on the scattering approach has been also validated with a full master equation simulation, seeing very good fitting whenever the time delay is longer than the characteristic times that take nonlinear to photon processes. Also, if you repeat the same analysis for the initial configuration, where you're making a hole at the center of the trap, now what you have is a mirror symmetry that doubles the frequency of the oscillation. But the rest of the signatures are very similar. So then, just to wrap up, what I've been discussing today is that in systems with a very strong coupling, even there is the effect of a single photon is able to largely change the atomic state. The emotional atomic state. In particular, this allows for an average heating per photon that is much larger than you would expect in free space, and also can manifest experimentally through oscillations in second-order correlation functions. Also, you want to take a look into the archive. There we also characterize situations that are closer to the experiments, where cooling down the atom to the ground state is actually challenging because of this enhanced heating. And what we observe is that we consider that the atom is initially in a thermal state, many of these features are expected to still be present in experimental conditions. And with that, I thank you for your attention.
Thank you. Do you have any questions? Well, there is some chatting here. Okay, can you expect with this to create some kind of comb-like wave function for your atomic?
Thanks again.
Can you expect with this kind of interaction to create some comb-like wave function for your atom?
Like engineering the...
Yes.
Yeah, so in principle we've been focusing on this picture of just making holes.
Okay.
But yes, basically what you are doing is the resulting atomic state when you detect a photon is kind of a convolution of the initial atomic state and the pattern of the reflectivity of the cavity. Mm-hmm. So you are able to shape the intensity profile in your cavity. You will also be able to tailor this,
yes, this
into condition. So then it comes to how well can you tailor, well, how well can you know the atomic state before this event, and how well can you tailor the intensity profile inside your cavity.
Okay. Thank you. Any other questions? Online.
Wow.
Yes. Yeah, thanks. Yeah, I had a technical question. Hi. I was just wondering, why did you consider, if there is any reason why you considered a photonic crystal cavity and not a free space cavity, or if this was just an example that you took?
Yeah, that's a good question. So the reason for this photonic crystal is basically it's one of the systems we know that offers a larger, I don't know where to look. That was one of the largest, largest coupling parameters. And in our case, that's interesting because basically we want the dynamics of this cavity is much faster, for example, at the frequency of the trap. So these traps in these experiments are in the order of hundreds of kilohertz, which are much slower than the dynamics of the cavity or whatever, which is in the gigahertz. So this allowed to separate more these timescales. In principle, believe that this will be not that prominent as these plots I've been showing, which are for the parameters in these photonic crystals. But in principle, if you are using, and also this allows for working with a single atom. So you can think that maybe in cavities with atomic ensembles, you can also get very large cooperativities. And then we expect that similar ideas will happen there, but probably the time scales will not be that separated. And also there is no motivation of these single atom physics. I don't know if that answers your question. But yeah, we believe it's also kind of universal. You go to other setups.
Yeah, thanks.
Okay. Other questions? So maybe we can take the speaker again and we can move to the coffee break, isn't it? No? Yeah.